Good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Apologies have been received from Colin Beattie this morning and John Mason is attending. Before we move to the first agenda item, I understand it's likely to be Michelle Thompson's last meeting with this committee. I would like to very much thank Michelle for her contribution to the committee and recognise the work she has done around women in business and women's representation. And these are issues that the committee will endeavour to continue to highlight. And I wish you all the best in your next committee. So our first item of business is a decision to take item 3 in private. Are people content to do so? So our next item of business is an evidence session with Royal Mail. Ahead of this session, the committee did put out a call for evidence and received a number of written submissions. I'd like to thank everyone who submitted their views to inform this morning's session. So I welcome Ross Hutchison, Operations Director for Scotland, and Ricky McCauley, Operations Development Director, Royal Mail. As always, would members and witnesses keep questions and answers as concise as possible? And I invite Ricky McCauley to make a short opening statement.
Oh, thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Let me say, first of all, that I've worked for Royal Mail for 37 years, having started as a postie in the south side of Glasgow. I'm exceptionally proud to work for a company that connects households and businesses in the communities across the reach of Scotland. Also proud to be one of the major employers in Scotland. We employ 11,000 people, good quality jobs in our sector. The average tenure of a postal worker is 18 years, so when they join Royal Mail, they tend to stay for a career. And 98% of the jobs we offer are permanent jobs in our sector. Royal Mail does need to change. I've laid this out in the written evidence. We're at a crossroads. The markets in which we operate have changed significantly and they continue to change rapidly. But we have an opportunity. We've had a difficult year in dispute, but we do now have an opportunity. We have a negotiators' agreement with the CWU that underpins a lot of change that is essential for Royal Mail to modernise and adapt in those markets. We need to harvest the benefits of the £900 million we've invested in Royal Mail's network to make sure we're fit to compete in what is an expanding parcel sector, and we're absolutely committed to improving quality of service, getting Royal Mail back to its best after that difficult a year. To update on one point in the evidence that we had submitted, the negotiators' agreement now with the Communications Workers Union is out at ballot. That ballot closes on the 11th of July. It's out with a recommendation to accept, and both the management of the company and the CWU are spending a lot of time at the moment explaining to the whole workforce why that agreement is essential for our future. On quality of service, we have not been at our best over the course of the last year. The numbers tell you that. We've been in dispute for a year. Royal Mail, not the only company in dispute, but we have been in dispute for a year. We've had prolonged periods of industrial action. Royal Mail, unlike other companies, we don't just cancel appointments, we don't cancel train journeys. We have an open access network, so even when Royal Mail is in strike, when industrial action taking place, we have an open access network and it takes us a bit longer to catch up. That has impacted quality of service. We've had elevated absence levels as well in our network, perhaps associated with that. The important thing is we have a plan in place to improve quality of service, an action plan in place in every depot that's not on target performance, and I'm sure we might get into some of that detail today. On the universal service, I just want to make it absolutely clear that Royal Mail is proud to provide the universal service. It's what makes Royal Mail unique. Enshrined within that is the one price goes everywhere, connecting everyone across the whole of Scotland, irrespective of what geography you lived in, at a standard tariff. We have no plans to change that, just to be very, very clear. But given letter volume has declined from the mid-20s, from about 20 billion letters to today around 7 billion letters, we do believe there's a need to deliver the letter, change the letter frequency of which we deliver from Monday to Saturday to Monday to Friday. And if you look at Ofcom's user needs review that they've undertaken, very extensive research, they say that that meets 97% of consumer and SMEs businesses today. So as I said at the start, I think Royal Mail does have an opportunity. Been a difficult year. We've got the agreement in place. We've invested significantly in our network. We're committed to improving quality of service. It hasn't been good over the course of the last year, and we do believe we need reform to the universal service. And myself and Ross are happy to now take any questions from the committee.
Thank you very much. As I said, we did put out a call for evidence, and the call for views, I think, did reflect the way in which people value the Royal Mail and recognise the importance of the universal service and how important that is, particularly to parts of Scotland. And I'm sure members will touch on those issues. But this is not the first parliamentary committee. The Royal Mails have been appearing in front of the Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy Committee recently, and that has led to Ofcom inquiry and to do with parcel deliveries. So some of the evidence we received did say that the service in the areas, people felt the service had fallen short of the current standard, that deliveries were only happening a few days a week. I think it's a familiar story we hear from our constituents. They feel their letters are arriving in a bundle. There's a prioritisation of parcels over letters. Can you maybe give us an update on the Ofcom inquiry and tell us, you know, how does it... I realised that the Ofcom did look at this during the pandemic and recognised there was a legitimate reason why Royal Mail would prioritise parcels during that period. But I suppose the concern is that that has continued as a practice. And it is something that, you know, I've heard from local sorting offices, I hear from constituents, their letters are coming in bundles, those types of issues. So if you give an update on the work that's been done by Ofcom, if that's possible, and how you see this, how the, if this is the picture that has developed in Scotland.
So Ofcom are investigating at the moment, and it's not just prioritisation of parcels, it's a quality service results for last year. We're cooperating with that investigation, so call for information, data, evidence. We always cooperate with Ofcom, and we've been meeting Ofcom on a regular basis, a monthly basis, to update on progress with quality of service as well. We expect that, my understanding, I can confirm afterwards, is that that concludes in November. So there'll be a period of time during which Ofcom will look at all the evidence from multiple sources, and they'll come to a deliberation. What we are saying in that investigation is that last year was truly unique. Royal Mail wasn't the only organisation to be significantly impacted by industrial action. It is regrettable. I do apologise to customers the length and breadth of Scotland that they've not been able to depend on Royal Mail the way that historically they have been able to depend on Royal Mail. But we've got a plan of action in place, and if there's specifics, then in Scotland, Ross can go into detail, whether that's recruitment activity in certain areas, establishing all the operating standards that we've got on our network that we know deliver great quality of service. And just last week, jointly with the trade union, as part of the agreement, and we're not waiting for the ballot to be ratified, there's a lot of joint activity in every unit with the trade union to put in place the actions that are required, and they are quite different in each unit. Some units it is recruitment, and other units it's been elevated levels of sick absence. But through the bulk of last year, the real issue that we've been dealing with is a prolonged dispute that that did impact on the service we were able to provide.
During the period of dispute, while Ofcom recognised that prioritisation of parcels was maybe necessary during the pandemic, was that a policy that was adopted during the industrial dispute in the past year, that parcels were prioritised over letter delivery?
Where there's a necessity to do that, then, and when I say what creates the necessity, parcels take up so much more cubic capacity in our network. If you look at our network in terms of the capacity of our trunking and our facilities, 10% of that network will be letters. 90% of the network is full of parcels. If we don't keep parcels moving through the network will grind to a halt, and we'll have to shut our door at the front end. One of the things we're very proud we didn't do at any point was shut our doors to customers. It took us a long period of time to catch up. So from a health and safety point of view, from an operational point of view, particularly if you take Cyber Weekend, where there was 3 days of industrial action, when we returned from that, we had to keep parcels moving. And part of the contingency arrangement would have been to maybe do letters every other day to make sure we can keep parcels moving, so we can repatriate containers back to customers who then want to post again. But it's not normal practice. It's a contingency arrangement for special events. And I think in Scotland at the moment, do you want to...
Yeah, I think, Convener, just to add to what Ricky said, I think in Scotland, as it is the case across the UK, it's been a difficult few years for Royal Mail. We've had COVID, we've had industrial action, we've had higher levels of absence than we saw before that. Again, as Ricky said, possibly connected to the overall feeling of, the industrial action creates by nature. I think as the economy settled as well after COVID, we see that we have pockets of Scotland where we've got higher than normal levels of vacancies. And we're trying extremely hard with a variety of approaches to close that gap. So we do recognise that there is improvements we need to make. I think just to be clear, I speak to my senior managers across Scotland on a daily basis. The managers that manage the postcodes, and I meet regularly with the trade union, as Ricky's outlined. Our objective is to deliver everything every day. That is absolutely what we want to do. And I think the reality on the ground as we look at our in-process measures is that we have a delivery point coverage in Scotland currently that's in excess of 90%. So that means that 90% of addresses are receiving regular service. That doesn't make it okay for the feedback that you receive, and for customers that don't receive that regular service. We recognise that, but I think as Ricky's touched on, the challenges we face that result in a requirement to manage the cubic space, on occasions they are not going to be resolved tomorrow. So the manager, the local manager, in line with the trade union, has got to make a decision that looks at how do I manage workload and how do I manage health and safety within this building for the next 2-3 days as we try to resolve whatever the particular challenge is.
And I suppose just two issues linked to that. When you're having to make a decision to prioritise parcels over letters, is there any look at what type of letters, because the concern is that it's hospital appointments. And I do recognise a lot of the letters that posted are birthday cards and stuff like that. There's kind of social post that goes around. Is there any distinction between letters that do have to reach people in time and other letters? And the second issue, which I'll just cover just now, is parcels. Are there penalties attached to parcels? Is there a financial incentive to prioritise parcels over letters?
I'll take the first part of that question, Ricky, if that's OK. I think just in terms of the importance of NHS mailing, we do understand that. We actually did a fantastic piece of work with NHS Scotland to identify, I think everybody will remember, the blue letters that you receive with the vaccination appointments. And it's that type of activity where we can identify NHS mailings that allows us then to make sure that we prioritise that through the network, because we all recognise how important that communication is. On reflection, we delivered 17 million vaccination letters across Scotland, which is clearly a huge number, and we're hugely proud of the work that we did to support the UK's attempts to manage the COVID issue. But where we can identify NHS letters, and I think even for context again, on any particular day, even at the peak of the vaccination letters posting, you might have a delivery that has 500 or 600 delivery points on it. The most we were getting was roughly sort of 20-30 vaccination letters per delivery. So that we were able to, where we could identify that, ensure that we secured delivery of those letters. And I think just to touch on the point that Ricky made, because I think it's important, we want to do everything we can to avoid a situation whereby you've got this weekly delivery. We don't believe that. My in-process checks don't tell me that's a regular issue across Scotland. We make every attempt where we can't deliver. If for whatever reason we can't deliver on day one, then we will ensure delivery on day two.
And the issue about parcels and financial incentives for prioritising parcels?
We don't, Convener. It's not something, there's not added bonuses for delivering.
But is there a penalty attached? If parcels aren't delivered within a time frame, is there a penalty that Royal Mail would incur because they've not delivered the parcel?
No, there's not. It's done purely out of operational and safety reasons. There's no specific penalty. Ofcom regulate both letters and parcels to the same quality of service standards. So if we fail the letters, we will, Ofcom will take the same judgment as...
If it's a company that are asking you to deliver, as my understanding, I think sometimes there'll be a delivery company. If you order something online, the delivery company, maybe they can't manage the delivery, they'll ask Royal Mail to do it. Could the company place a penalty on you if it's a 20-hour or 48-hour delivery, if it's not delivered in that?
The main product that we've got is the USO product, the 1 o'clock guaranteed special delivery. During industrial action, we take the guarantee off because we know we can't provide the service, and we've done that through the period of industrial action. The when it comes to the penalty that we face is customers ultimately walking away and using another supplier. That's the only penalty we would face. Contractually, with our tracked products in our network, there's not penalty clauses in those. It tends to be the ones that we advertise compensation is available, which would be that special delivery product, which is a USO product. It's not.
Okay, thank you. Maggie Chapman, followed by John Mason.
Thanks very much, Ken. Good morning, both. Thank you for joining us this morning. I'm interested in exploring some issues around workforce and workforce planning. Royal Mail's plan has been to cut the number of staff by 10,000 by August this year, and in fact, you achieved that by March, April time this year. I was wondering, could you tell us what proportion of that has happened in Scotland? And what are your, Ross, you mentioned that the pockets of vacancies in Scotland, what are your plans for dealing with those geographically specific vacancies? But I'm interested in the workforce planning, the bigger picture thing.
Pass to Ross in a moment to talk about specifically in Scotland, but across the whole of the Royal Mail network, we have reduced our full-time equivalent headcount, full-time equivalent headcount by 10,000 jobs. That's a very significant reduction. We recognise that, and it's happened on the back of two or three key reasons. Industrial action has not helped, and we knew that would be the case. Royal Mail doesn't have a monopoly in parcels, and there's many other companies out there. If Royal Mail are not at work, that other carriers will use. So we have lost. We have lost volume due to industrial action.
Can I just come in? And do you think that's primarily why you achieved the target four or five months early?
It's part of it.
Part of it. Okay.
So it's responding to market volume, essentially. The second aspect is we had a plan underlined to improve efficiency. It's probably three relatively equal buckets. Reduction in volume due to industrial action, improving efficiency in line with our agreements with the trade union, and thirdly, the reality of the broader macroeconomic environment in which we're operating. Royal Mail is a company that thrives in the back of GDP. If GDP is growing and consumer confidence is high and people have disposable income, advertisers will advertise. So it's good for letter volume. Addressed and unaddressed letter volume. If people have discretionary income, they shop online more. And we know the reality is at the moment that things are incredibly tough for people. Incredibly tough, be it inflation and now interest rates, cost of fuel, which means it has an impact on Royal Mail. So we've had to right-size the network also to the reality of the economic environment that we're operating in. So that's the reduction in 10,000. But to be clear, the agreement and everything, we want to grow Royal Mail. We want Royal Mail to get bigger. We operate, and a lot of the investments we have made is about allowing Royal Mail to compete in the parcel space. Letters will always be important. You know, 7 billion letters are still really important to Royal Mail, to be clear. But it's a declining sector. It's a declining market. Parcels are growing. Mm-hmm. And the investments we've made is about competing in that parcel space.
Before we talk about the place-specific things, can I just unpack that a little more? Do you know how many other 10,000 FTE are in Scotland? Or
yes, Ross can touch on that.
I think just to give context on the around about roughly 11,000 jobs, that's been pretty static for a number of years. I've similar to Ricky, I've worked for Royal Mail and proud to do so for 20 years, and that number hasn't fluctuated hugely. The FTE, or the full-time equivalent, as Ricky's referred to, that is a balance of all of our resource mix. Right. So it's a balance of contracted staff. That also includes agency staff, and it includes overtime. The reduction that we managed in line with volume in Scotland was around about 700, so it was pretty comparable. Okay. With consistent with that UK, that overall UK number, and we've managed that in line with volume. However, what I would point out, I think it's worthy of note, we're actively recruiting around 300 people in Scotland currently. Mm-hmm. And that is because we do see those microeconomic factors in specific locations where we don't have enough staff at the right time of day to complete the work. And we're seeing we're advertising at the moment a variety of roles at different times of day. So we see a growth because customers demand it of PM work, weekend work. That we've got real growth in those areas, and we're actively recruiting across Scotland now for people to fill those positions. And again, I think, as Ricky said, we're proud that these jobs are permanent jobs. Mm-hmm. They're good jobs. And I think just on the reduction, we didn't make anybody compulsory redundant. We've got a continued commitment with the trade union that for the length of the agreement that's at ballot at the moment, we won't make anybody compulsory redundant. That's a commitment that we've made. There was a small number in Scotland. It was a fraction of that 700. It was roughly 100 employees who took voluntary redundancy in Scotland as part of that reduction. And the rest we managed through attrition, a reduction of our casual staff.
Mm-hmm. Okay, no. Thank you for that clarification. That's really helpful. Just on the sort of balance, and you say, you know, that the evening and weekend working that you're recruiting for, I suppose one of the questions. You talked about, Ricky, you talked about the three chunks of areas where why that workforce has been reduced. And you talked about efficiencies, improvements in efficiencies. Is that to do with the refocusing of where the volume of deliveries or collections need to be? Is it to do with a geographical focusing? Can you just, how do those two things match up?
So, as much as Ofcom meet Royal Mail regularly and talk about quality of service, they also meet us regularly and talk about efficiency, as you would expect any regulator to do. Our reality is that we have a significant range in performance across depots that are very similar. So it is about narrowing the range of performance from the lower performing units to match those that are kind of median performance moving towards upper decile. Performance. That change locally is difficult for people. People like the routine and what they've always done, and what does it mean practically? Maybe adding another 40, 50 households to a postie to try and improve efficiency, where our data tells us we've got the opportunity to do so. And equally, as I said, that's something that we do report to Ofcom on a regular basis. So it is performance range, and it's about levelling up performance to a level that we know is achievable. And the bulk of our units.
Just to support that, because Rick, we have touched on the interaction we've got with the trade union. Mm-hmm. I think one of the positives we've got out of the negotiators' agreement is the joint commitment to both productivity and quality of service. Only last week, actually, Ricky himself was directly involved in a UK-wide call where we had all the reps and all the managers from every delivery office across the United Kingdom on a call to discuss what we needed to do in both those spaces. And we've just launched this week a checklist that every unit rep and manager will systematically work through to understand where we've got gaps in quality of service and where we've got gaps in productivity. So I think that's a huge step forward.
Okay, my final question, if that's okay, just on that, I mean, you talk about the relationship with the CWU, and I'm just wondering, given that you got to a position where they are recommend, you know, that there's a clear recommendation for the ballot, what is your perception of morale across your workforce?
I think we've got a lot of work to do. I need to be honest, I think we have a lot of work to do. I think we need to set responsibility for that. I don't think you go through 18 days of industrial action where employees suffered a lot of loss to get to the agreement that we're now recommending. So, you know, we need to be empathetic to that. We understand how our workforce are feeling, and part of what Ross just referred to is that process of re-engagement. We do want to get the deal done because we can put money in people's pockets, which will, in a very practical sense, help them, some back pay and some lump sum that's been released as part of the agreement. I think that will help. But actually, let's be honest, postmen and postwomen up and down the country love serving their customers. They want great quality of service, the same as we do, and actually getting back to our best will help restore pride in Royal Mail, which is what we're committed to. That's what we're committed to doing.
I think just to add some context as well around local relationships, because I think that it's important. And we do understand that I think any organisation that's been subject to industrial action will see some of the issues that Ricky's articulated. Locally, though, we do see really strong relationships between local managers and posties who are really proud to serve the communities that they serve. Even through industrial action, we saw our employee engagement scores move from 62 to 68 to 70 in terms of that local relationship and how they feel they're supported and managed by the local manager. So I think the foundations of good relationships are there. And the national UK-wide agreement gives us the opportunity to move that forward.
OK, thanks. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. John Mason to be followed by Jamie Huckle-Johnson.
Thanks so much, Convener. So, first of all, thank you for your service to my office and me personally. And I enjoyed my visit recently to the centre in my constituency. To follow on the employment theme, it suggested in your submission that you were actually having challenges recruiting people in some areas. Can you expand on that as to where that is and why?
Yeah, so I think it's similar to other industries and other employers. I think we do find you see microeconomic factors that impact on our ability to attract people or prospective employees to the organisation. We've had to adapt our approach. We've worked incredibly hard over the last year in Scotland to be flexible in that in our approach. So rather than maybe if I think back to 5-6 years ago, we were only offering part-time jobs. We're advertising now a range of full-time and part-time jobs to increase the attraction, because we understand the people and the cost of living pressures that they face want a more secure job that has longer hours, and in certain locations that is required to attract the right talent. On the islands, one of the things that I worked hard to secure was that the specific allowances that are attached to islands, we've protected that as part of the national agreement, so that we're going to move forward and continue to understand that people in some locations find different pressures and the cost of living can vary. In some locations in Scotland, as we advertise on our website, we actually offer an attraction payment as well, attraction and retention payment, which is a one-off payment on the basis that people apply for a role with us and they stay for 12 months. So we're adapting our approach depending on the factors that we face in different parts of Scotland. So the islands are difficult. Edinburgh is difficult.
Edinburgh's difficult. Is that because you're competing with other delivery companies, or?
Yeah, I don't think. I think it's cross sector in Edinburgh. Actually, I think generally, the economy in Edinburgh is relatively buoyant, and there are other opportunities for people to seek employment elsewhere. So we've got to react to that.
Do you think Brexit has an impact on that?
I don't have an opinion on that. We react to the factors that we see, and we see that through the applications that we have for the roles that we advertise, and we monitor that regularly and react to that as best we can with a variety of approaches as I've walked through.
Okay, and I mean, if I don't want to go into the why you're going to 5 days, other colleagues will raise that. But if you do go to 5 days, will that have an impact on the number of staff you have?
If you look at overall, what we're trying to do is make sure we put the resources against where the market's growing. So that would largely depend on how successfully we grow our parcel proposition and our share of the parcel market. So see, a lot of our investment that we've made is in competing in parcels. We're increasingly expanding parcels out to a seven-day network. That creates employment. If we do that well, then we can offset the decline decline in job numbers associated with a reduction in the letter frequency delivery from 6 days to 5 days. I know it's not answering your question directly, I apologise, but it really does depend on Royal Mail grasping the opportunity that's now in front of it, working closely with the trade union and all of our employees to make sure we deliver what customers expect. And if we can grow and the opportunity is there to do that, then it will offset the type of job reductions that would be associated with a change to the letter delivery frequency.
OK, so there would be job reductions purely linked to the letters, but hopefully they would be compensated for elsewhere. And with these job reductions, presumably that would be just all over the country. I mean, it would be even, because if everybody goes down from 6 to 5...
Yeah, so it would be across the whole of our network, across the whole of the United Kingdom. That would be the case. We wouldn't differentiate where we've done 5 or 6 day letters. It would be one change across the whole country. And I have to say, we have in place that non-compulsory redundancy guarantee for our for our people, because we have a lot of overtime. We use elements of agency workers from time to time where we need to, although that's not our preference. So we have other means of making the job reductions, which is why we've given that commitment to our employees.
Okay, and you, I mean, you mentioned the competition, and clearly a lot of this, the changes within Royal Mail are linked to the fact you've got all this competition out there. I mean, what do you do better than the competition, or what do they do better than you?
But I think Royal Mail has a unique brand. Yeah, we need improved quality of service. So that doesn't last forever. But I think we have a unique brand. Our foot on the ground delivery model. So we don't deliver parcels point to point. 85% of the parcels that we deliver with letters, and they're delivered on foot. So from a CO2 point of view, we are half the CO2 impact of other parcel carriers that deliver on a point-to-point parcel network. It's an advantage that we have. We're looking to sustain. We need to leverage the investment in our network. We're now at 80% of parcels network automated in our network. That drives the unit cost of parcels down. And you know, we need to compete on service as well, as I've said. I think the one thing that makes Royal Mail unique is our reach. It's the fact we go everywhere. People like to deal with one supplier rather than a supplier for somebody who does a bit of the UK and a supplier that does all of the UK. So they're all important factors in terms of how Royal Mail compete with other carriers. But we do need to differentiate on service.
I think one of the strengths we've got as well is, I think Ricky referred to in his opening statement, the fact that we've got employees that work here for an average of 18 years, and I think that's a real strength. So the culture that we've got within the organisation, that desire to serve the communities, I think is a real strength that we've got. That's an advantage that we've got that we need to leverage. Trust on the doorstep, trust with our customers. Our net promoter score in Scotland, for example, is extremely high. It's approximately 70%, so 70% of the people who receive deliveries from Royal Mail are an active promoter of the service that they've received. And I think that is representative of the service that our people want to deliver.
Do you think there's still trust in Royal Mail more than in any of the other competition?
Yes, but we can't take it for granted. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Royal Mail is, it's everywhere. It is trusted, but we can't take it for granted. That's why I said in the opening last year's not been the service people have experienced is not what they expect from Royal Mail. And we need to get back to being the best in the market. Customers, many of our customers will pay a bit more to do business with Royal Mail, but they've got to have the trust. And it's their postman and postwomen up now the length of the country that turn up on the doorstep every day that makes Royal Mail unique and different, in a uniform, not in a private car, proper good quality jobs here to have a career. That's how we can differentiate.
OK. Thanks so much, Convener.
Thank you. Jamie Harkle-Johnson to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I mean, just on that point, I think regardless of some types of service, the work that's done by posties, certainly in my area, Highlands and Islands, are very much appreciated out in all weathers. I think any of us that go campaigning in all weathers appreciate the efforts that are made. I was just going to ask, obviously in remote and rural and island communities, there are concerns that service isn't as regular as it is already currently in other parts of Scotland. Can you advise some of the kind of challenges, some of the concerns that you have about delivering that the current six-day service and how that might be impacted if there was a five-day service?
I think, first of all, to respond to that, I think it's a fair challenge. I think we've already articulated that we do have a recruitment challenge on the islands. I think unemployment on some of the islands is extremely low, and there are factors that reduces the availability of potential employees for us that we've got a variety of approaches to try and address. And actually, we're making significant progress on that at the moment in Scotland. We're seeing that's improving, and that is having a result whereby we're seeing service stabilise. I think the logistics of islands as well, there's additional personal logistics, as I'm sure everybody will appreciate, to serve island communities. Everything, every item of mail that enters Scotland for delivery goes through four mail centres, so Glasgow, Edinburgh, Inverness and Aberdeen, and clearly then to serve some of the most remote communities, we've then got to have a structured local pipeline and logistics network to serve that. And that is reliant in some cases on third parties and indeed other external factors such as weather. We've got to fly to the islands from the parts of the north of Scotland, and clearly the weather sometimes can be challenging, fog bound. We've even had fog as recently as the last week, actually, whereby flights couldn't land, and that can impact on service. And clearly to some of the islands on the Inner Hebrides off the west coast, we use a lot of ferries as well. We work with external contractors to support movement of mail to some of these locations. So logistics are challenging, but we're committed to delivering as strong a service as we can. I think it's worth noting that the Ofcom do recognise that, particularly for the HS, KW and ZE, which are the Shetlands, Orkneys and Western Isles postcodes. They acknowledge that it will be very difficult for us to deliver consistently to the same level of service as we deliver to the mainland UK for those reasons.
Thanks very much. And I mean, somebody with a KW postcode myself, I do recognise that. One of the things I would kind of ask is, I mean, if a letter arrives at a sorting office, a delivery office, will it always go out as soon as possible? Or would, for example, you sometimes, I don't know if the right term, but, you know, bank or put a few letters together from perhaps a remote household or remote community to make sure that you weren't doing kind of one journey just for one piece of mail? And or do you try and ensure that there will always be, if there's a piece of mail to be delivered, it will be delivered on the day it should be?
So we do everything we can to deliver everything every day. That is the objective, and that is the objective that we measure performance again in the number of delivery points that we covered. There is a challenge in getting letters and parcels to some of these locations, but once it's there, our objective is to deliver everything that we receive on that day on the day. If it doesn't, for whatever reason, because of whatever factor that we've experienced, whether that be vacancies or sickness, etc., we will do everything we can to deliver that the next day. We don't make decisions on the basis of it's a difficult place to go. We'll leave that for a couple of days. That's not our intention at all.
Okay, that's great. And the last thing I was just going to ask about, kind of what consultation you're doing with the local communities. Obviously, you know, it impacts on them, it impacts on local businesses. So what consultation do you do with them on the service that's provided, what they need, and how regularly do you do that?
So we work, I think, on the specific to the 6 days to 5 days, because I recognise that was part of the questions. Apologies for not responding to that. I think Ricky would agree, in terms of the UK-wide data, that we don't see any indication that rural communities will be disproportionately affected by that. We do lots of work with our external stakeholders regularly in Scotland. We work we've got an external relations team that work closely with the Parliament, with parliamentarians in this building and in business groups outside of that. We're really, really keen to understand the service that we're delivering and what impact we can have. It's only last week that my area manager for Highlands and Islands was actually in Orkney with some of the political figures and business leaders to discuss service that we're delivering at the moment, and indeed what opportunities there are for enhancement of that to react to what people's requirements are. So we do want to actively listen. I think, just to be clear, on any move from 6 days to 5 days, it won't be an overnight light switch either. So we know that there's a lot of work to be done. If we did move from six to five, there's a lot of work to be done to understand how we can support external organisations to react to that.
Is that consultation, though, including households, just ordinary users, rather than just businesses?
Absolutely. I think we've done a piece of work in conjunction with Ofcom to understand that has included people who live in Scotland and people who live in remote locations in terms of their needs. We do want to understand any potential impact that we'd have and consult with a range of stakeholders.
OK, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Colin Smith, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Convener. Just on the issue of the attempts to access the Saturday letter deliveries, I mean, you've said several times this is still obviously your aim, this is still your desire, but the reality is it's not going to happen, is it? The UK government have said no already, so you need to obviously move on from that plan. But how central to your current strategy to return to profitability within the next 2 years was moving to 5-day deliveries? And if that's no longer there, what's your strategy now?
Given that you're quite right, we're not in control of it. It's ultimately enshrined in the Postal Services Act, and there would need to be a change to that Act in Act of Parliament. There's a lead time for that to happen, which members of the committee will know is not overnight. It would take between 2 to 3 years to achieve an Act of Parliament, unlikely to happen before the next election. So we did not have that baked into our plan. We do believe that actually requiring Royal Mail to continue to provide the service that the vast majority of customers now say is no longer needed. 97% of customers in Ofcom's user needs review, it's an extensive review, said a 5-day letter delivery service would meet their needs today. So requiring the provider of the universal service for a prolonged period at cost to continue to provide that service is not in the long-term interest of protecting the universal service. That's why we think government do need to act, and we'll continue to make representation about why that is important. Ofcom, when they set up the regulatory framework, said the universal service provider should be able to make between 5% to 8% margin from their activities, profit margin from their activities they're doing, to reinvest in the business. Any business needs to make a margin. We've only made that margin twice since Royal Mail was privatised. And letter volumes continue to decline every year, not just here in the UK, across the whole of the world and across the whole of Europe. We're very much in line with the decline that we're seeing elsewhere. And we'll continue to work to try and revitalise letters, but the truth is people find other ways. And, you know, we have a number of initiatives that we have in play on letters to try and defend letters as much as we can. But so in direct answer to your question, we believe the change is needed. We'll continue to lobby and make the case for that change. We believe it's important to the future sustainability of the universal service. Importantly, the one price goes everywhere that Royal Mail offers today. And it wasn't in our cash flow projections, and therefore it's not an impact on our business plan over the next couple of years.
Something that does appear to be in your business plan is reported changes with the pipeline you use to get mail to delivery offices. If I can use, I suppose, my own area as a way of illustrating that, I represent the south of Scotland. I'm based in Dumfries and Galloway. The mail currently comes north to Newcastle Airport. It's transported to Carlisle, which I appreciate is out with your area, but we are classed as Carlisle for deliveries. It then heads, obviously, to local delivery offices in Dumfries and Galloway. You now plan a number of, I suppose, central hubs, in this case, Warrington. Could you tell us what this will mean in terms of the time that mail, for example, will reach the delivery office in Stranraer compared to what time it reaches that office at the moment?
So let me give the overview of why we're making the change. I think that's important. Royal Mail still flies 36 flight sectors a night, connecting the network. It's always done that, historically, moving letters around the country. No other parcel carrier in the UK uses inland UK-based air transportation to move the product about. Our experience of air transportation as a means of moving parcels about, highest CO2, it's the least reliable, and it's by far the most expensive. There are better alternatives. So rail and road, significant lower CO2, and improved quality of service for our customers. So if we're going to compete and meet the needs of our customers, we need to reduce our reliance on air transportation. It doesn't work when the cube of the parcel is growing every year and the volume of parcels are growing every year. That means that the transit time in the middle, which an air sector, 60 minutes, road and rail goes more like 3 hours. So it's not 2 hours later everywhere, just to be clear, in terms of the delivery span. We can save some time in the middle within our network, but the agreement we reached with the CWU says the last letter delivery time will move from a latest last letter delivery time of 3 o'clock to 4:30, and that would reflect also in the start time in the morning, which would be up to 60 to 90 minutes later in the day. And we're doing that so we can continue to deliver letters and parcels together in a combined network for the vast majority of the parcels we carry in the network. Putting more planes in the sky, it just doesn't work. I can go into a lot more detail in this. We've looked at
let's be very clear. I'm not disputing at all the need and the importance of moving from planes to trains. Frankly, that's something I support. What I want to know is what you're doing to mitigate in those areas that are further away from the hubs that will get their mail arriving at the delivery office several hours after they're currently getting that. What does that mean for customers in terms of when they will get the letters? This is a rural area, for example. You said 3 o'clock. I think it's not 4 o'clock for rural areas at the moment. What will that mean for those customers in rural areas who will get the mail to the delivery office several hours later? So therefore, by definition, it will take a later time to deliver that. What time will people start to get the letters in the rural area?
So to be clear, the last letter delivery time will be 4:30.
In every area, it will not go beyond 4:30.
To be clear, there's current exemptions to the 4 o'clock today in isolated areas of the network where we deliver up to 5 o'clock. I don't believe Stranraer is part of that, to be clear. I think it's the far north of Scotland into some of the island area. So what we're saying is deliveries will be completed not at 4 o'clock, but by 4:30. Many of those deliveries today are completed at 2:30, 3 o'clock. Don't actually work through to 4:30. We see that in a lot of our data. So the last letter delivery time will be 4:30.
So you'll be putting extra resources into those areas to make sure you hit that 4:30 target.
We'll move back the start time in the day to make sure that people aren't in the office when the mail hasn't arrived. So part of it's about moving start times in the day, and it may require us to look at duty attendance patterns within the unit as well. But there'll be essentially what we call a revision, but a change within the unit to accommodate the new arrival profile and that last letter delivery time. Whether it attracts investment will depend unit by unit.
I think just to add to that, again, one of the benefits of the agreement is that the CWU believe, and clearly they've got representatives across the network that are close to it, they actually believe that they can support us to advance some of this network activity. So we've got a joint working group at UK level, and we've got a joint working group that we're about to set up at Scotland level, where we can look at what can we do within the network to mitigate the time that it arrives in the delivery office, as you've articulated the journey of a letter, if you like, to Stranraer. I think Ricky's right on the 16:30. I think that one of the benefits from flights or the removal of flights and moving to a greater reliance on rail and road is the reliability that we see. We see our air network is 6 times more fragile. So although a customer might receive that letter up to 16:30, it's more likely to be there on time the next day, because we'll get a greater level of reliability from that network, and that's what we want to achieve.
Can I turn to another issue? We can give an evidence to the House of Commons Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy Committee. Your chief executive admitted that postal digital assistants were basically being monitored and had been used to pressure staff to work faster. Can I ask, do you ever monitor staff social media platforms?
Staff social media platforms. So yeah, if it's private to them, then if it's closed groups, then we wouldn't do. If it was an open group and they were making inappropriate comments or anything that brings the company into disrepute, then we wouldn't expect them to do that. We don't slavishly monitor it, but if it's brought to our attention, we would follow up.
So there have been cases, because clearly in recent months, I think around 22 staff have been dismissed in Scotland. How many of those cases was it based on partly social media posts that they had put forward that you had been monitoring?
I don't have that level of detail where I could. Some may have been. I wouldn't want to say a specific number because I just don't have that level of.
Don't seem a bit sinister detail, though, to be monitoring what staff post on a social media platform.
I think every employee that works for Royal Mail needs to act responsibly. Anybody who uses social media needs to act responsibly. It's a public platform. They are responsible for what they put. They put on there, and if something on there is wholly inappropriate or threatening towards one of our other employees or brings Royal Mail into disrepute in some way that we don't find acceptable, then we would follow those up. But I don't have all the specific details to respond to that specific question that you asked.
Just one final point. You've raised the issue of recruitment several times. I mean, am I correct and saying that the pay deal now means that new staffs all get paid about 20% less than existing staff, and for example, new staffs lose their allowance for lunch, for example, they don't get paid over lunch. Is that the case, that the terms and conditions for new staffs will be inferior to the existing staff? I mean, presumably that's had an impact on retention and recruitment.
So we don't see that having an impact on retention. And recruitment. So the change you're talking about is the terms and conditions that we're now offering as we bring new employees into to Royal Mail. One of the things the CWU were very, very keen, and it was at the heart of the dispute, is that we don't become a gig economy employer. This is an alternative to becoming a gig economy employer. We don't want to be a gig economy employer. But equally, we can't support wages that run 30 to 40% above the market in which we compete. So the jobs that we are offering are still 10 to 15% above the market. You're quite right, they are around 20% less. If you take in working time, they're about 10% less, but that's your point about the paid breaks. In many, many locations, not in every location, as Ross has alluded to, we're getting 30 applicants for every job that we advertise. We'll keep a very, very close eye on what we're offering. It needs to attract talent into Royal Mail, and the right talent into Royal Mail. But it's enabled us to protect. There's another 130,000 employees in Royal Mail that have the contracts I've had for a very long time. Making this change enables us to protect the contracts that we offer to 130,000 people that, as I said, have served Royal Mail loyally for a long period of time.
But you're not seeing any changes in retention, you're not seeing any changes in turnover at the moment?
Not immediately.
From new starts at all?
We haven't seen, in Scotland specifically, just to support that, I haven't, to be honest, looked at the detail UK-wide, but we aren't seeing within our new entrants that are under the T's and C's that Ricky's articulated, we don't see a particular spike in attrition that's beyond what we would normally see. Look, the job is a unique job. It's a very physical job, and it's a job that people that a lot of people love and stay for years, and people find difficult. And sometimes I think the perception of what being a postie is and the reality, I think we touched on that in the committee already, in terms of the weather that you're exposed to and the challenge of the role. It can be really rewarding, but some people find it's quite difficult. So we do see that people. We've always had evidence of that, whereby people have joined and left. And we're not seeing a particular spike in that with the new terms and conditions. It's abnormal to what we would normally see.
Treatment challenges, though.
Yeah. Can I just say the point you're making is correct. You know, we need to watch very, very closely what we've got at all times, what we're putting into the market. And if we see attrition is growing, or we see in certain areas it's not competitive enough, we're going to have to make a response so we can attract the talent we need into the company. But what we're trying to do is keep Royal Mail as an employer that offers good quality jobs, permanent contracts, pension, sick pay, in terms of all the things that our employees enjoy. These are not gig economy jobs. They're different, you're right, to the jobs that have been there previously, but it enables us to compete in a market. Let's be honest, it's surrounded by gig economy players. We don't want to look like that, but we have had to make that change.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener. Morning. And I want to go back to the topic of five-day working that we were speaking about earlier. Can you just say what impact moving to five-day working would have on collections?
So we would continue to offer a level of collection service on the Saturday. That would be done on the basis of demand. So we would not go to every single post box, for example. So if I give you an example, at the moment Royal Mail collects somewhere in the region of 85,000 of 115,000 post boxes when the post is out delivering. So they're not going to be out delivering on a Saturday, therefore we would not be out collecting from all of those post boxes. It just doesn't make economic sense. Where we have post offices that are generating a lot of volume, we would look to continue to offer collection services from there, from business customers, and where there is demand for a service, we would continue to meet it.
So basically, you collect from most post boxes around about tea time, 5-6 o'clock. So if somebody posts a letter on a Friday night in response to something they've received when they get home from their work on a Friday, you're not going to be picking that letter up until Monday tea time. So that's 72 hours that's going to be lying in a box. Is that not just going to further undermine people's belief in the postal service, that they're having to wait 72 hours for the letter to be collected, and then up to 2 or 3 days for it to be delivered to the recipient?
So just at the moment, we'll collect those post boxes when the post is out delivering.
Yeah,
so
you want to change that.
We will, on the Saturday, they wouldn't be out.
Yeah.
They wouldn't be out doing that. They would be collecting that on a Friday for delivery. If it's a next day item for delivery on the Monday.
Yeah.
But if I
come home from work on a Friday, I get in the house at 6 o'clock. There's a letter I need to respond to.
Yeah.
I stick it in the post box at 7 o'clock on a Friday night. That's not going to get picked up until Monday at tea time.
Yeah, and delivered on the Tuesday. Yeah, that's correct.
I think it's just to support that, because I think it's a fair question. We would work. I mean, we need to work through this level of detail, because it is in some ways hypothetical. But we've got a recognised approach to prioritise boxes anyway that worked through the pandemic, if we reflect on it, because we were able to say for test kits that we had with priority boxes, so we could signpost members of the public to specific boxes that would be emptied. And I think that it's that type of approach that we would need to take if we didn't collect from every box, but we had. If you want to look at it that way, a priority, right. Priority boxes.
So we've talked about the impact on the letter post. What about parcels? Is there any plans? I know we're talking hypothetically here, but you've said that you believe that change is needed. So what about parcel collections? What would be the situation with that? Would that still be 6 day collection or what?
So it depends where the parcel's. If it's a small Jiffy Bag parcel that's going into one of those pillar boxes with stamps on it, then clearly it wouldn't. Unless it's a dedicated collection box. I'm talking about the items that we collect on delivery. There's still options through post office. Royal Mail launched one of the things that we're proud to have done over the last year, Consumer Collect. So when the post is now out on delivery, we collect on the doorstep. We'll still be out on the Saturday delivering parcels, to be clear. We'll still have around 20,000 people out on a Saturday delivering parcels, because the demand is for not a 6 day but a 7 day parcel network. That's what retailers are demanding of Royal Mail. And therefore, their ability when they're out there to do collection on the doorstep is an opportunity that we would look to exploit as well. And we offer business collections as well as part of a service that we have today.
What about convenience stores that maybe act as a collecting point for returns from shopping catalogues and things like that? Would they still get the Saturday collection?
We tend to use post office for that. So if there's an item that's due to be either our own customer service points or post office. That's the outlets that we have available. I have to say, earlier this year, we launched something called auto redelivery. So rather than when we can't deliver a parcel, just putting a red card through the door saying you need to go and collect it, we now give a second attempt. And we're now up to the very high 98.5% delivered to the household. That's the customer's greatest preference. That's where they want the parcel delivered. But if they do need to collect, it's either they can have the item left in a safe place, they can give us that instruction, or they can collect it after that second attempt at the sorting office, or have the item redirected to a post office. We're trying to find the most convenient way for customers to receive their items. I have to say, all the research says the most convenient way is they want it delivered to their home, which is why we've done that auto redelivery second attempt.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you. Graeme Simpson?
Thanks a lot. I just want to follow up a bit on what Gordon MacDonald was asking about the letter delivery. So if you get your way and you can go down to 5 days delivery, that's clearly a poorer service than we currently have. Do you think, I mean, Gordon outlined a scenario where a letter could take several days to actually arrive. Do you think in those circumstances there's any point in continuing with first and second class stamps? Should we just go to a service where everybody gets the same? There's no point me putting a letter in with a first class stamp in on a Friday, say, when it won't, under your scenario, arrive on the Saturday.
So we haven't put that forward as our primary proposal. So you're quite right, you've articulated what we have proposed, 6 day letters down to 5 day letters. I wouldn't be surprised if Ofcom, as part of the ongoing review of sustaining the universal service, don't look at that. Many other, I spent some time last week with 15, 16 other postal administrations. Several of those administrations have moved to a single tier service. I don't really want to comment on it much more because I don't have enough data or detail on the pros and cons of that against the pros and cons of reducing the letter delivery frequency. But I do think it is something inevitably that we will end up looking at if there's going to be a reform of the universal service.
That's fair enough. It's just something that occurred to me. If we do move to that situation.
The others, I have to say. Yeah.
Okay. Can I ask about your use of agency staff? What's the level of agency staff that you use as opposed to fully employed by Royal Mail?
It really varies depending on the time of year. And the kind of demand in the network. If I put aside the industrial action, because Royal Mail is obliged by Ofcom to have a contingency plan in the event of industrial action to do our best. So, we would have had 10,000 plus, maybe more, agency casual workers in the operation, trying to expedite the speed at which we recover. Over our peak season at Christmas, as much as we give a lot of overtime to our postmen and postwomen, there's so much, only so much they can do. We would add at that time of year around 15,000 seasonal workers at that time of year to our network. But underlying, as I said, 98% of the jobs we offer are permanent contracts. Part of the agreement with the CWU is to try and significantly reduce the level of agency workers that we're using in the network. I can follow up and write. I don't have the exact number of what's in the network today. It will probably be in the low kind of thousands. And it's not to say they are full time. If I give you a specific example. We've expanded the Sunday service. We're now delivering for a number of customers on a Sunday, and it's not very popular with our own team. You know, the postmen and postwomen don't really want to be out there on the Sunday. That's why the new contracts that we've got, when somebody applies for a job, it stipulates they need to work on a Sunday. So at the moment, we are using maybe around 1,000, it's not a precise number, agency people that are working on a Sunday to make sure we can provide that network. But that's not our preference. You know, we want uniformed red vans out delivering for Royal Mail. Back to what I said earlier, it's what differentiates Royal Mail.
I think to support what Ricky was saying, we actively review that unit by unit in Scotland every week and say, what was our agency usage last week in that location? What were the reasons, what as to why we used that flex resource? And is there the opportunity to create that or to turn that into to a permanent job? We actually see quite a lot of agency staff converting to become Royal Mail employees, and we actively do encourage that. We've got people who've worked for us, who've enjoyed it, have clearly had the ability to do the job and the desire to do the job, and they can convert onto Royal Mail jobs. So we want to use that keep that the usage level as low as we can. It really is for the points that Ricky articulated, and we do review weekly. Site by site, can they be converted to permanent jobs?
Okay. Are you looking at the use of drones to deliver it?
We have done some initial trials in Islands of Scotland, and I think with Isla Sicily as well. At the moment, they are trials. In terms of scaling, but what we do know is in terms of reliability, they're more reliable in inclement weather. At the moment, all of the legislation that is required to fly drones out of sight and remotely is not in place. That's something that we've been lobbying, trying to make progress with, so that we can think about, is this truly a scalable solution that allows us to... develop a use case that is scalable and that we can use as an alternative to an aircraft, other forms of transport or emergency items, medical items, things like that, and open up a new market. But it's exploratory, it's trials.
How's it gone? I mean, in your view, do you see it as a goer?
I think it's too early to... to say for sure. I think we would need the kind of entry point, the price point to come down a bit in terms of the level of investment required to operate. And as I say, we do need changed Civil Aviation Authority in terms of our ability to fly drones over the kind of distances that we're talking about. What we've done so far is controlled trials. There's broader legislation change required if it's to be a scalable solution, but it's definitely worth exploring some of the remote islands. It would be more reliable. The payload's increasingly getting larger in terms of what drones can carry.
I think the number, you're right. I think Ricky's point is valid. There's around about 150 populated islands in Scotland that we serve, so it is significant. And when we say in populated, some of them are extremely remote with small populations that lends itself to that type of method of conveyance, if we could make it work.
Sure. Okay. We'll watch that space. I want to ask about your delivery officers. Now, you've said you've got four main, I guess they're sorting centres, and then they would go out to local offices. And by the way, a bit like John Mason, I visited my local one recently in East Kilbride and went round with a postman, and so that was all very good. So you've got the four main sites, and then stuff goes out to local sites. How many of those local delivery offices do you have? And are you looking to? A lot of them will be quite old buildings, maybe not suitable. Are you looking to modernise and make close down offices, move offices?
So there's around about 170 local delivery sites. We also have an SPDO network as well in Scotland for the most remote of communities, whereby we operate in conjunction with potentially postmasters that run small post offices, and we rent a small space in addition to that. But we operate with around 170 delivery offices. There's not a huge plan to amalgamate them. We do constantly review the estate. We have put investment. I think that we did note that in the written submission with some details to the committee. But we have invested in some of those sites as best as we can, given the financial challenges that the organisation has faced. I visited Dunbar actually a couple of weeks ago. They're trying to we've taken an external building and we've transformed that into a parcel sorting site, which is which is going to be good, and it helps us move forward in line with the strategic direction. We are reviewing the estate. We do recognise that huge parts of the estate are old and require some level of modernisation, and we try to do that as best as we can.
But you haven't got a number of offices that you need to maybe close and open up.
We'll constantly review opportunities to make our network slicker, but we don't have a mass plan in Scotland to reduce the estate significantly below the 170.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Just a couple of questions. So in 2019, there was a £1.5 million fine that was to do with first-class post-delivery failures. I understand that's part of the Ofcom investigation at the moment, is to do with performance. You did recognise at the start disappointment in the current performance. So when would you see us returning to pre-pandemic performance in terms of the universal service obligation? Is there the Ofcom inquiry is ongoing. I think there hasn't been a decision made yet whether a fine would be applied this time, and when would you see pre-pandemic performance returning?
So we are working very hard to restore service across the whole of the network. We meet Ofcom on a regular basis, a monthly basis, to update on progress. I'm not going to commit to a timescale, convener, here just now. That's something that we are discussing with Ofcom. We recognise that we, for the reasons that I've outlined, have not been at our best for customers. I've also said that actually for Royal Mail to win in the market, we need to get back to being our best. There's many imperatives to improve service, the least of which is the avoiding a fine, I have to say. So I'm not going to commit to a timescale to say we'll be back on the quality of service target by a specific timescale. It's something we're discussing on a frequent basis with Ofcom. Mm.
And Consumer Scotland, they are doing a kind of short investigation into Royal Mail. We had them in front of us a few weeks ago. They're a new organisation within Scotland, and I understand they are looking at Royal Mail service from a consumer's point of view. I'm not sure when that's going to conclude. They've shared some information with us, but I think it's on the public domain around postcodes that are performing below the UK average. Some of the areas we've talked about today, but other ones are just matching. That's areas that I represent. I've got some of the postcodes that are below the UK average. But would those be within Scotland? Is that covered by some of the issues we've already discovered around remoteness and difficulties with reaching areas, or is there other factors why we're seeing particular postcodes? The ones that are below are DD, FK, IV, KA, PA, PH, KY and ML are average. We do have ones that are above average, but they're still not hitting the target that is set.
No, I think that's fair. I think, as Ricky has highlighted, we don't want we recognise we haven't been at our best. I think in Scotland, just the nature of the geography of Scotland is quite unique in the context of the UK. We actually cover 33% of the UK landmass, and with that, the postcodes that you've articulated, some of them are exposed to some extreme geographies. We've talked about some of the north of Scotland postcodes. The PA postcode covers the islands, as well as urban conurbations such as Paisley. It covers the Inner Hebrides. The PH postcode is as we talked about, you know, ranges from Perth in the south to Aviemore, Granton in Spain, the north, Fort William in the west, and actually there are islands off the west coast of Scotland that are PH postcodes as well. So there's some logistical issues. I think there are other factors in some of those postcodes. So I think, you know, it would be a fair challenge to say, well, the DD postcode isn't particularly geographically remote. In the context of our local network, that's service from Edinburgh. So there is a decent transit time from Edinburgh. So any mail for Dundee goes through Edinburgh. So there are some logistics there. But actually, what we see in that example is it's a particular location whereby we've got higher than normal levels of absence that we see in other parts of Scotland. We see sick absence in Scotland around about 5% in some locations. It can be higher for a variety of reasons that we work hard to understand. So there are different factors in different postcodes, and I think that the nature of Scotland and the geography of Scotland lends itself to some additional logistical challenges on top of the challenges that we see UK-wide. And I think that when we look at quality of service in terms of where it is in Scotland, and it isn't where we want it to be, but it is consistent with what we see in the UK.
Mm-hmm. Can I just ask if no one else has any other questions about the price of a stamp? Because it's Royal Mail that sets the price of the first-class stamp. I think this is correct. And the second-class stamp is still capped by Ofcom. And what we have at the moment is, I think it's £1.10 for a standard first-class letter, and it's 75 pence for a second-class. So it's 35% dearer. That's almost a third dearer. Do you have any... It does seem the price of stamps have increased quite dramatically. Does that have... I mean, you've seen a reduction in letters. Do you take that into consideration that it might be one of the factors of why we've seen a reduction in letters, particularly at Christmas or areas where people are looking at high volume of stamps, that £1.10... There's a question of whether that's still is it still affordable? Do you know, we do recognise that in the UK we have a very valued service, that we have a universal obligation that other countries don't have, and you know, we recognise that you reach every point of the UK, and that is really important and valued by people. But we have seen it's quite a big increase in the cost of a service that people took as an everyday service. The concern would be that it's now become a special service that they only use on special occasions, that they wouldn't be prepared to pay that for the postal service. So what consideration is given to the increases in the first class stamp when you're making those decisions, when the Royal Mail is making the decisions?
So there's a number of factors, Convener, that we look at. The first is the letter volume decline, because as letter volume is declining, we're still having to provide the 6 day a week universal service. So there is a cost associated with that. Royal Mail is not in.
Do you think part of that is possible? Maybe it's not. I mean, it's very anecdotal. But you know, you have older relatives who think, I'm not going to send a card anymore because it's £1.10. I'm going to send an email. Now, I know £1.10 is, you know, a third of a price of a coffee. It's not. But it's maybe just the perception that people have, so it's encouraging the shift to something else, because I think maybe it's the pace of increase that's making people feel that the increase is not something they're prepared to pay. It's maybe the pace rather than the amount that's putting people off sending. It's kind of discouraging them sending.
Well, yeah. they do have the option of posting the item second class 75 pence, so there's quite a big differential.
But then you discuss if it's a special card, you could be wait 5 days. You know, it's recognised it's slower. And yes. I think it's, you know, I know 3 days the target, but it does feel a second class stamp now is quite a bit slower than a first.
If you look at, so I'm saying, we've got the volume decline in the network, we're trying to sustain the universal service. Royal Mail is not immune to all the inflationary pressures. It's a large network distribution organisation, and some of those inflationary pressures need to be reflected in what we charge for the services we provide. If I use some of the European benchmarks, the average across Europe is £1.25 for a next-day service. Many of the Europeans charge £2 for a next-day standard USO type letter service. So I think we do represent good value for money when you benchmark it across the rest of Europe. And if you look at the Office of National Statistics data, household spending on postage is 0.2% of household spending in total. People typically spend less than 90 pence a week on postage. But we've got to find the balance. I think the point you're making, the more expensive we make it, the people stop using it. That's the balance that we've got to always try and find. And And you're quite right, Ofcom do look at the second class. And in fact, they look at both in terms of there being an affordable mail service. So any time we change the prices, we do that in conversation with Ofcom as well. The one thing I would say, it's not that Royal Mail is charging £1.10 and making £1 billion of profits on the back of it. We're not. We're trying to survive at the moment, get the company back into profitability so we can invest in securing their future.
OK, if there's no other questions from members, that brings us to the end of this morning's session. Thank you both for the evidence we've heard. That's been helpful to the committee. I will now move into private session.